woman saying that the city of White Plains waived its right to a hearing. There was more crookedness, and so I wrote to the mayor of the city of White Plains, and that's where we'll pick up next week, to be continued. And I wrote to every member of the Common Council, showing them what a terrible thing it was that they have Joseph A. Maria representing them. To be continued.
Hi there, everybody. Welcome to the White Plains Harrison edition of A Chat with Glendora. We are exposing a crooked landlord and a crooked judge, two crooked judges, Freya and Washington, White Plains City Court, and we are exposing crooked lawyers. But first of all, we have three jokes for you. And Bob and Marion, there were earthquake shocks, and so they sent their 10-year-old son deep into the country with an uncle where the son would be safe. And the next day, they got a telegram from the uncle that said, "I'm returning the boy, send the earthquake." And Arthur was told by his doctor, "You mustn't shovel snow. You're advanced in your age, and you could have a heart attack." And so Arthur went home, and he said, "Son, would you please shovel the snow?" And the son said, "Yes, Dad, I'll start immediately." And Arthur had a heart attack. A boy brought home a report card from school, and it was all A's, and the father said, "He must get his brains from me." And the mother said, "He must. I still have mine." We are up to volume 2 out of 19 volumes of Crooked Lawyering, Crooked Judging, and Crooked Landlord. And this is Glendora's post-trial memorandum of July 1997. Glendora went in person to the clerk's bar 5 times and asked if Judge Leake ever ruled on this petition. And she said not. Nothing had been done on it. On June the 23rd, 1997, Monday, a clerk told her that it had been denied, that Pat Loopy was sending Glendora a letter saying so. But Pat Loopy told the clerk who was talking to Glendora, "It isn't typed yet." Who was talking to Glendora, "It isn't typed yet." Glendora said, "Then I have no notice and I don't have to pay." But Glendora would rather do right even though others don't. She waited until Pat Loopy typed the letter. See Exhibit 3, page 16. Then Glendora went into courtroom B to ask Joanne Freer to reduce the fine and give Glendora time to pay, but she never got the chance because, as you remember, Joanne Freer screamed at the top of her lungs at Glendora. There's the Pat Loopy letter. Freer was wrong to take the matter out of Judge Leake's hands. It was not fair to do so. Joanne Freer should not have butted in. Further, Joanne Freer recused herself from Glendora's litigation, and Glendora had to go to another judge. Motive. History of Joanne Freer's unconstitutional animus against Glendora. In the landlord-tenant dispute, Glendora was the victim 3 times of sewer service under penalty of perjury. 3 different people swore they had served Glendora personally. They had not. These 3, Patrick Rudo, Wayne Cheatham, and Mark Gudeman, committed perjury, ever had in personam jurisdiction. This is Glendora's right, and she is not waiving it. Glendora handed these 3 sewer service into the Westchester County District Attorney. And I think I was going to sue Janine Pirro, because they did nothing about it. They let it go, and that's not what they're there for. They're there to protect you and to protect the laws of the state of New York and the county of Westchester. But Janine Pirro's having enough problems with her husband being indicted for income tax evasion. So I have to think about that. Joanne Freer denied Glendora a Travis hearing 3 times. Then, with no grounds at all, ruled that the service was adequate. These perjuries and filings of false instruments were ruled by Joanne Freer to be adequate. Another crooked by Joanne Freer. We've counted them up and counted them up. What is it, about 50 by now? 50, 5-0. Glendora wept for her country and the raping of her court's processes. She sued John Porzio, the landlord, Friedrich Lehrman, and Mark Gudeman, the lying lawyers, Rudo and Cheatham, who probably didn't even exist, and Joanne Freer in the United States District Court. The violation was civil rights, Title 42, the United States Code, Section 1983. Violation of civil rights under color of state. And 1985, conspiracy. On June 12, 1997, 2 p.m., trial date, Joanne Freer came to the bench and recused herself because she had been named a defendant in a federal lawsuit. She turned the case over to part-time Judge Rosanna Washington, and that's all she is. She's a lawyer the rest of the time, and she's a part-time judge. Every court appearance, Glendora exercised her right to audio tape the proceeding by asking the New York State court officer to ask Joanne Freer for permission. Freer's absolutely not, quote-unquote, rang throughout the whole courtroom. When you look at the account of what she did on June the 25th, 1997, Wednesday at 9:30 a.m., you can understand why she doesn't want an audio tape of it. But Glendora has a witness. Glendora wanted Joanne Freer to see Police Chief Bradley's letter. The red light ticket was a fraud and still is by a lying policeman, James Stead. It never happened. He lied. And Judge Friedman denied Glendora's videotape of Stead wrongfully giving her a summons. Friedman is another crooked judge. Thank heavens he's out, along with Reap. The reason Glendora wanted Freer to see Bradley's letter is that Glendora is the first to commend a policeman who does his work in honesty and honor. The letter is on page 20, and Freer blocked presentation of same to her. And this is the letter. I wrote this to Chief Bradley. About a White Plains policeman who had done his job. Glendora has 8 hours of videotape evidence and 2 hours of audio tape evidence against landlord Porzio, Lehrman, and Gudeman, demanding these be produced by, Judge Freer did not order at their cost, and Glendora has no money to pay for dubs, and look at all the money the lawyers and the landlord have. Then, instead of having Gudeman come to Glendora's home where she has all the equipment to screen the tapes, Joanne Freer made Glendora 69 and Franklin 78 carry all of the boxes to Gudeman's office. That was not an honorable decision. What's we got now? 52? 52 cheats by Joanne Freer. 42, and Joanne Freer talked to Gudeman about it ex parte on June the 16th, 1997, Monday in court. That is an outrage. Glendora called the Gudeman-Lehrman office on June the 16th, 1997, Monday at 8:30 a.m. and said the tapes would be ready for screening in her home today at 2 p.m. Gudeman called at noon and said he talked to the court clerk and we had to bring everything to his office. Well, he was lying. The clerk said she never talked to him. That would be Betty Stewart. Gudeman was talking to Freer ex parte, just as Glendora caught him red-handed ex parte with Rosanna Washington on June the 27th, 1997, Friday at 9:45 a.m. Glendora's next grievance is about this. While we are on the subject, there is no way a citizen can just get justice in the White Plains City Court with Lehrman and Gudeman in that court, sweet-talking with the judges every single day. Gudeman is there every morning romancing the personnel and ingratiating himself every slimy way he can devise. This has to stop. Judges and clerks are all too intimate with Gudeman. Ergo, Glendora is petitioning for change of venue. In another grievance, Glendora will tell you how Gudeman manipulated Rosanna Washington into robbing Glendora of the $13 dubbing costs for the videotaped evidence. That's per tape. And that's cheap. We strongly suspect Joanne Freer was trying to do us out of our taped evidence and that Rosanna Washington is perpetuating the dodge. This is how they both did Glendora out of her right to a jury. When a litigant goes to court, a litigant wants justice. Gudeman comes in and sits in the juror's box as if he is king. Glendora wants jurors in the juror's box. It isn't that Judge Freer doesn't not have the time. One day she entertains 15 second graders each sit at her bench and pretend they were judges. It was nice, and she gave each one a miniature gavel. Joanne Freer should have dismissed Porzio's eviction action long ago. He has no grounds. He is breaking the real property law, harassing a tenant, and more, retaliation because Glendora reported him to four public authorities and violating the warranty of habitability. The rent has always been paid. He lied that it wasn't. Now we pay it into court. It is taxpayer waste, but Joanne Freer is too close to Mr. Gudeman, who comes to her court every morning. We need a change of venue. It is bad judgmentship. And the order to deny Glendora's motion to dismiss is not on paper. A judge can say so, can say no nicely. A judge can say no and say it nicely. A judge does not have to have a temper explosion the way Joanne Freer did. Franklin did not offer his life D-Day to VE Day, Normandy to Weimar, to have America treated this way. Now, to whom this grievance is reported? Chief Judge, State of New York, Judith Kay, Joseph Trafficante, Office of Court Administration outside New York County. Jonathan Lippman, Office of Court Administration, New York County. He lives in Rye. Cy Shulman, Mayor of White Plains. Common Counsel, White Plains, who appointed Joanne Freer and Rosanna Washington as city judges. They are not elected. Glendora's TV audience, you. Joanne Freer, Rosanna Washington, Governor Pataki, Center for Judicial Accountability, Incorporated. Commission on Judicial Conduct, Gerald Stern, lives in White Plains, over around Gedney Way. This paper was dated White Plains, New York, June the 29th, 1997, when Joanne Freer screamed at Glendora from the bench. And now, here is a note to Rosanna Washington, City Court of White Plains, 77 South Lexington Avenue, White Plains, New York. Today I produce the videotaped evidence again. The first time the videotape evidence was produced was 6/16/97, Monday at 2 p.m. That day I left two tapes behind, my mistake, in Mr. Lehrman's office. John Porzio screened one of the tapes and owes Glendora $13 for it. These are the people who get all the money, and yet they're too cheap to pay their own way. Today, Franklin handed clerk Betty Stewart four videotapes. Each is 2 hours long. This is the 8 hours Glendora will use for her videotaped evidence at trial. Each tape is $13 dubbing charge, and believe me, that's cheap. It's more like $150. And is not to be released until Mr. Porzio pays $13. For each one and pays it up front. Okay. Glendora is sorry to report that over in U.S. District Court, Cablevision still owes Glendora $120 for an audio tape she produced, and Judge Bryant ordered defendants to pay. This bad experience makes Glendora insist on payment up front in cash. $13 times 5 is $65 to be paid cash when Mr. Lehrman picks up the tapes from Mrs. Stewart. The audio taped evidence is 2 hours. That will be $26 and will be produced next week. Glendora has lost 200 hours of her life finding the incidents here and there over 130 VHS tapes, each 2 hours. Then the relevant incidents have to be dubbed onto one tape, and that has taken 20 hours. Then a dub has to be made of the master, and that takes 2 hours per dub. $13 is not consummate for the labor and the eyesight. Many production houses charge up to $70 per dub. Glendora gave Mr. Porzio the lowest quote that she could find, $13. The videotape dubs are ready to be handed into court today. Glendora screens 10 audio tapes a day to find the Porzio conversations. So far, 20 have been found out of 60 tapes, 90 minutes each. There will be dubbed next week onto 2 audio tapes and brought into MS Stewart. There's much more footage, but 10 hours is all I can handle. Yours in truth, Glendora. Chat with Glendora. Copies to Washington, Rosanna Washington, Betty Stewart, Lehrman, and Porzio. Notice of motion in motion for change of venue. Movement is Glendora, and the date of this is June the 29th, 1997. Return date is July 16th, 1997, 9 a.m. Location is courtroom B77, South Lexington, White Plains, New York. A room of injustice. Relief requested is change of venue to Peekskill. Grounds are several and gross violations of ex parte, bias, prejudice, and intimacy. Supporting papers are all pleadings of Glendora and Franklin, written and oral, to this court and the New York State DHCR, all incorporated and reiterated here in, as if fully stated, attached affirmation and grievances. Legal basis is CPLR Rule 510-2. Further relief requested is the cost of this action and any different relief that is just and proper. Dated White Plains, New York, June 29th, 97, to Lehrman, Guterman, and of course, Porzio. That certainly should have happened, right? Change of venue because of all of the prejudice and all of the bias and all the crookedness of Joanne Freya and Rosanna Washington. Affirmation by Glendora, grievance against Judge Rosanna Washington. Under penalty of perjury, Glendora tells you the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help her God, so help all of us God. On June the 27th, 1997, Friday at 10 a.m., Mark Guterman was caught red-handed in ex parte with Judge Rosanna Washington. The sequence of events is listed in front. Glendora took 3 VHS tapes, 2 hours each, 6 hours total of evidence against Porzio to clerk Betty Stewart with the enclosed letter, Exhibit 1, pages 3, 4, 5, and 6 herein, which was just read to you. She left the 3 tapes with M.S. Stewart with the request they not be released to Guterman Lehrman without their paying cash, $13 times 3 equal $39 plus $13 for the tape Mr. Porzio saw on June the 12th, 1997, Thursday, without Glendora's permission. The total is $52. Then Glendora and Franklin went to courtroom B to monitor proceedings. Glendora and Franklin have been court monitors since 1992. Rosanna Washington was at the bench. Mr. Guterman approached the bench. There was no other party present. The adversary did not show. Mr. Guterman talked into Sato Bocci. To Judge Rosanna Washington, their faces were less than 2 feet apart. She granted him what he sought, a warrant of eviction, and insisted on a 5-day stay. Mr. Guterman was wrong to cover up what he was saying. The courts are a public process. He should speak up so everybody could hear. Grievance against Rosanna Washington. Then Mr. Guterman asked Rosanna Washington if he could get out of paying $13 for each of Glendora's videotapes. Guterman did not know Glendora was in the courtroom. Glendora caught Guterman red-handed committing ex parte. He had no right to talk about the Glendora case to the judge without Glendora present. Guterman got his plea through to Rosanna Washington. Glendora caught Judge Rosanna Washington red-handed ex parte. Then Glendora heard Rosanna Washington say to Guterman, "Well, she's here." Guterman wheeled his body 180 degrees and was aghast to see that Glendora and Franklin were indeed present. Caught him. Think how many times they did it when I wasn't there. There was a pause. Rosanna Washington said, "Mrs. Buell, will you come up?" Glendora said to Franklin, "Do you want to come up?" Before Franklin answered, the judge says, "Mr. and Mrs. Buell, will you please come up?" We did. Judge Rosanna Washington failed to hear us. She made a ruling without hearing us. She heard only Guterman's request. She heard it ex parte. She ruled without hearing from us. Guterman does not have to pay $13 for the VHS. Is that crooked or isn't it? Why do the rich rob the poor? There are two grievances here. The first is Judge Rosanna Washington was caught by us red-handed, ex parte, so was Gudeman. The second is it was a cheap thing to do. Everybody knows that videotaped evidence is produced at the cost of the party demanding it. They demanded the evidence. They have to pay for it. How cheap this court is, the city of White Plains. It's because the judges are appointed, they're not elected. Glendora is in forma pauperis. Her sole income is $480 a month Social Security, $7 per year stock dividends, and Social Security is not taxable. Look at all the money lawyers make. It was grossly unfair. See the work, hours, and dollars Glendora put into producing this videotaped evidence. And this is the second time Glendora produced the videotaped evidence. So, one, it was ex parte. She had already decided before hearing Glendora. Two, it was a cheap skate thing to do. And then Glendora, from the jury box to pick up his, Gudeman went to the jury box to pick up his belonging and makes goo-goo eyes to Judge Rosanna Washington. Yes, he makes goo-goo eyes to Rosanna Washington. Glendora and Franklin stand at the door, vigilant for any more ex parte. Gudeman goes out to the clerk's office. Glendora asks for her three videotapes she left a half hour ago, explains the cheap Rosanna Washington decision to Clerk Stewart, hands the three tapes to Scott Shylock, Gudeman, scot-free as Franklin and Mrs. Stewart witness. Next, Glendora takes 10 minutes ex parte to Clerk Stewart about another cause that Gudeman has in his court. I watch Gudeman talk ex parte to Betty Stewart for 10 minutes. There can be no impartiality in a court where Gudeman comes in every morning and sees a judge and talks to the judge with all this camaraderie and unconscionably talks to the judge about Glendora's case when Glendora is not there to give her side. The judge is swayed by one side. The ruling is made without Glendora's being heard. Thereby are grounds for grievance against both lawyer and judge and grounds for change of venue. The second grounds for change of venue. Both Joanne Freer, recused judge, and Rosanna Washington, present judge, are wrong to rob Glendora of her right to a jury trial pursuant to real property actions and proceedings law, section 742. Glendora demanded a jury trial in her first paper, answer to the notice of petition and petition. No way can Glendora and Franklin expect a fair and impartial decision after what has happened thus far. Third grounds for change of venue. Both judges Free and Washington are wrong to do everything they can to prevent Glendora from presenting her taped evidence against Mr. Porzio. 8 hours of videotaped evidence and 2 hours of audiotaped evidence. Fourth grounds for grievance, for change of venue. Judge Washington is wrong to let a witness testify against Glendora, said witness, a personal friend of the judge. Further, Judge Washington would not let Glendora ask questions about the judge's relationship to the witness and overprotected the witness 8 times. Fifth grounds for changing venue. Judges Free and Washington are wrong not to sign Glendora's subpoenas. Sixth ground for change of venue. Judge Washington is wrong not to rule against Friedrich Lehrman's devious attempts to do Glendora out of her warranty of habitability, an inalienable right. Seventh, Judge Washington is wrong to allow witnesses Fendler and Brady when Glendora demanded a witness list and it was ignored. And witnesses should have been precluded instead of trial by ambush. Judge Freer recused, but she still calls the shots, and Judge Washington does whatever Judge Freer says. Judge Freer still runs the show. Both Judge Freer and Washington are wrong not to let Glendora review the court record of April 18th and September 2nd on audio tape. This is a frivolous case, and a judge whose soul was not sold to lawyers Lehrman and Gudeman long ago would have dismissed. Mr. Porzio has no grounds for eviction. The rent is paid. Indeed, we ended up evicting him. We have never harmed his property, only taken the best of care of it. The rent is paid and always has been. It is now being paid into the court. Mr. Porzio is breaking the real property law, harassing a tenant to move, retaliating because tenant reported him to 4 public authorities, and violating tenants' warranty of habitability as evidenced in 8 hours of videotapes and 2 hours of audio tapes. 11th reason for change of venue. So far, it is taxpayer waste and waste of scant judicial resources. If Glendora had not been robbed of her jury, she could have made an opening statement and given an overview and focus to the trial of June 19, 1980.